582. We will worship the King. We will sing 1, 2, and 3. Only.
Gloria. Says the Lord God. I will seek the lost And I will bring back the scribe, and I will build, and I will bound up the injured, and I will strengthen the weak. But the fat and the strong I will destroy, and I will feed them with justice. Therefore, thou say the Lord God to them, I myself will judge between the fat sheep and the lean sheep, because you push with flip and shoulder and button at all the weak animals and your horns until you scatter them far and wide. And I will save my flocks, and they shall no longer be reviled. And I will judge between the sheep and sheep, and I will set up over them one shepherd, myself David. And he shall feed them and be their shepherd. And I, the Lord, will be their God, and my servant David shall be prince among them. I, the Lord, have spoken it. This is the words of the Lord.
The psalm appointed for this psalm is Psalm 95, verses 1 to 7. We read together. O come, let us sing to the Lord.
Let us make a joyful noise to the Lord,
the rock of our salvation.
Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving.
Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise.
For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the heavens and the earth, and the earth is the mountains and his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and the dry land which he has formed.
O God, let us worship your God. Let us sing before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of our destruction.
O Lord, let us sing to the Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever.
Second reading, Ephesians 1, from 15 to the end. I have heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, and your love towards all the saints. And for this reason, I do not cease to give thanks for you, as I remember you in my prayers. I pray that the Lord of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, might give you a spirit of wisdom and revelation as you come to know him, so that with the eyes of your hearts enlightened, you may know what is hope to which he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance among the saints? And what is the unmeasurable greatness of his power for us who believe, according to the work of his great power? God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places. For above all rules and authority, powers and dominion, and above every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the age to come. And he has put all things under his feet and made him the head above all things for the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in it. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Who are members of my family? You did it for me.
say to those at the left hand, you that are accursed, depart from me into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not come to me. Naked, you did not give me clothing. Sick and in prison, you did not visit me. Then they will also answer, Lord, when was it that we saw you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or sick? Or in prison, and did not take care of you? Then he will answer them, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it for me. And these will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Brethren, this is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, my Christ.
Let us pray. Our Father and our God, we bless your name, we honor you for this wonderful day. Thank you for our lives. Thank you for the grace you have given us. We are here celebrating Christ the King for this year 2020. It's a wonderful thing. We cherish it. And we are here for you, O Lord. Now, Father, we are ready to hear from you. May you speak to us again. And may your word bring blessing and consolation to our hearts. These we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. The theme for today's sermon, the final judgment. The final judgment. We celebrate the kingship of Christ today. He is indeed the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The world do not know this. Christians all over the world know this and acknowledge it. This celebration reminds us of his coming again in glory to judge the world. And I ask all of us to please do this with full heart of worship so that he will bless us. We are here to do what many people in the world will not know about. Often they don't even want to know. But we have to, we have the privilege to know. And we need to demonstrate it for people to hear it loud and clear. That indeed he reigns. One funny thing is that the world did not make him king. He doesn't require anybody to make him king. He is what he is from the creation of the world. So he does not need our election. He does not need an electioneering campaign as we used to do in the world. And that may be the problem why many are finding it difficult to agree or to understand it at all. I was hungry, and you fed me. Thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you received me in your homes. Naked, and you clothed me. In prison, you visited me. Matthew chapter 25, verses 35 to 36. Today is Sunday. Sunday next before Advent. We are still in the season of great expectation of His second coming. Anytime we begin to hear about Advent, we are talking about expectation. And the Advent marks the end of the Christian calendar of that particular year. And we are just finishing year A. At the end of Advent, we will enter year B. And it goes like that. It's a three-year cycle, A, B, C. So year A is finishing. So the season is still there. The great expectation is still there, which means more room for our preparation. It's a privilege. Today we celebrate Christ the King to remind us of His second coming with power and splendor to judge the world. Today's gospel covers what we should be expecting on the day of His appearing. One of the major things that will happen on that day is that there will be a separation. The good will be separated from the bad, according to the narrative. The good will be separated from the bad. That is what we must be expecting. That's what it will look like. And that is why Jesus explained it to His disciples and to us. That when we know it clearly, we will know that it is not a joke, and we will not afford to joke with it. This will help us to be more serious with our preparations to receive it. We have to stop the argument of whether He will come or not. We have to stop doubting. This gospel narrative confirms what Prophet Ezekiel said in the first reading. Ezekiel chapter 34, verses 20 to 24. He says in verse 20 and 21, "So now, I, the sovereign Lord, tell you that I will judge between you strong sheep and the weak sheep. You punish the sick ones aside. You push the sick ones aside. Booted them away from the flock. On that day of His coming, there will be a separation, one at the right side and the other on the left. Those on the right will receive words of comfort for doing what is pleasing to God. Those on the left will receive words of condemnation for not doing what pleases God." The gospel narrative helps us to understand that all the good works we are doing or we do for our fellow human beings is to God, and all are recorded. All the good things we do for our fellow human beings, the gifts we buy and distributed to them, the clothes we provided for them, the little money we give to the beggars, you are doing it for God. That is what the scripture is saying. And it's on record that these are the things that will count on that day. These are the things that will qualify you to be directed to the right hand side, where words of comfort will be released. And I pray that all of us will belong to that side. Amen.
Amen.
God is happy when we do those good works. When we fail to do them, God is not happy. As simple as that. If you are doing good, God is happy with you. If you choose to do evil, He will not be happy with you. The question now is, which side do you think you will find yourself when this separation takes place, especially if it is now? If you assess yourself, if the trumpet should sound right now and the separation commences, which side do you think? Just consult yourself in one minute. Consult yourself and reason out. If Jesus is to come right now, and what he has said in this narrative begins to happen, which side do you think you will find yourself? Think about this. And I would suggest that we please act now that the chance is still there. It's still open. He has not come, at least for today. He hasn't come. But he can come any moment from now. So you have to start preparing as if he will be coming the next second, because it's possible. He might be coming at the close of today. So take your preparation serious, because what he told us will happen exactly the same way. The separation will take place. And that is where the gnashing of teeth will start, before people will find themselves in hell. Because it will be a disappointment. Everybody will wish to be put at the right side. But the record is going on. He is recording your attitudes. He is recording your acts. It is what is found in that record that will determine the direction you will be asked to go. So the opportunity is still open, and I plead that we use it wisely now that the chance is still there. Amen? Amen. Remember that there will be gnashing of teeth for those who find themselves on the left side. In the second reading, Apostle Paul prayed for us, asking God to give us the Spirit who will make us wise and reveal God to us. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17. Anyone who wishes an answer to this prayer should shout aloud amen to it. Amen. If it is your wish that this prayer will be answered, just say hallelujah to the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And accept that prayer, and it will be so for you.
Amen.
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 Because if the Spirit makes us wise, we will be able to do what pleases God always, and win his approval. It is the Spirit in us that will help us to do these things God is expecting us to do. And that this prayer is that Spirit will be given to us even now, so that he will help those who are still doubting. They will stop doubting and then take the word serious, and then they will live to enjoy this goodness of God he has already promised for all those who will believe. In Ezekiel chapter 34, verse 11, the scripture made it clear that God does not enjoy seeing sinners die. He rather wishes to see them stop the evil they are doing. Now, why do you want to die? God asked. Look at the wish that everybody will do right. That is the wish of God. He doesn't want anybody to go to hell. But people, greater number of people, over 90% of human race, have chosen that path without knowing. They are heading towards hell. And God is not happy for that. Is not his wish. So that's why you ask that question. Why do you choose to go where God does not want you to go? Why do you choose to enter into that lake of fire which God does not want to see anybody he loves there? Why do you choose? The reason is that the free will is still there. God doesn't want to take it away. He enjoys seeing you worshipping God from your heart, not because you are compelled. No, nobody should compel you. If you want to worship God, it will come from your heart, and God will accept your service. And that is what we preach always. And we pray that everyone will accept this message and do the needful. And that means needful is to repent now from the evil ways. Repent now from the bad things you are doing. That's it. Once you change from it, you become a friend of God once again. And you have so many things to enjoy here on earth as you wait for the most glorious one in his appearing. Psalm 95 verses 8 to 10 says, listen to this, to what he says. Don't be stubborn as your ancestors were at Meribah, as they were that day in the desert of Massa. There they put me to test and tried me, though they had seen what I did for them. For 40 years I was disgusted with them. I was disgusted with those people. I see how disloyal they are. They refuse to obey my commands. And I want to say, please, my good people, learn from the mistake of others. Allow a change of heart in your life and be blessed. Amen.
Amen.
Say the creed together. We believe in one God,
Father and Lord, maker of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ. He who is the Son of God, and from the Father of God, God of all, God of all, true God of all, true God.
joy will be full. That is the will of God for us. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for the world. Remember to pray for all the troubled countries of the world. As we pray again for Peru, as we prayed last Sunday, continue to pray for Nigeria and other countries that are in turmoil. That the Lord will grant peace to the world as we celebrate the kingship of Christ today. Let there be peace where there is no peace for some time now. Let it be the gift the world will receive today because of God's mercy and love. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for the church, asking God to continue to use his priests, his bishops, and all people serving in his vineyard, to use them to bring succor to the family of Christ and the world, to serve with the same spirit which the Lord himself put in us. We want to see all the servants of God doing the will of God. That will be a very clear proof to many who are still in doubt. They will see the words of God and they will acknowledge it. Let's pray that God will use his servants to achieve this and spread his blessing all over. Lord, in your mercy, let us pray for those in need. As we hear from the sermon, we've not seen that God does not play, God does not joke with people who belong to this category. The needy, the hungry, the naked. God cares for them. Let's pray that this message will reach them so that they will know that the King of Kings cares about us, so that they will always live in hope, and we know that that hope never finishes. That this hope will carry them on and on, and then help them also to do the will of God. Because to be a beggar is not an excuse for somebody to be doing anything anyhow. There are many other ways they will satisfy what God is expecting from them, and they will be blessed at last fully. Lord, in your mercy. And let us pray for those who are perishing. I mentioned it, greater number of people in the world are heading towards hell. This is supposed to be a verdict to you and I who say we believe. God himself said it is not his wish that anybody will go to hell. And the question will be, what are we doing as people who have the mind of God in them to help these people to talk sense into them? That is the message of salvation. The truth is coming. He's coming in glory. He's coming to judge. At his appearing, mercy should give way. It will now be judgment. Based on what anyone does, the judgment will be given. No plus, no minus. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We bless you for hearing our prayer again. Thank you for taking over all our burden. We know that as you always do, you will do it again. And bless our week. And bless our weeks coming for the year to go. We are ready to celebrate the end of this year. We know you have already given it to us. We are only counting time to celebrate it. We are saying that Jesus will reign forever. He will reign forever. Let our lives continue to reflect this, O Lord, so that many more people will get it clear. We bless you, we honor you for everything you have done for us today. Be with us to the end of the service and release your final blessing to us. This is our prayer through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding. Keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Amen.
Our final hymn, 52, we also sing 1, 2, and 3. At the name of Jesus, every knee.